mininghrd.com and has got 37 years of industrial experience. He has held various posts in Tata Steel and worked in Nigeria, and currently working as a consultant for mining industry. So at the outset, I welcome you all, sir, on behalf of Department of Mining Engineering and on behalf of our college, and also on my own personal behalf.
Thank you. Thank you, Vishal.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So I now invite our principal, sir, Dr. Praveen Podduke, to give his address. Please, sir.
Thank you, Professor Kishore Mule. Respected guest speaker, Dr. Ajaya Shankar Gupta, Ainapur, founder and CEO of mininghrd.com. That I got. Nice program on hazard identification and risk assessment with focus on coal mines. Congratulations, organizers of the department. A very good topic. Actually related with the energy, with which I myself has been related, though I am not a mining engineer. So energy, we know, is related with the number of activities. If you just go in deep with what is energy, it is a capability to produce motion, force, work, change in shape, everything. So this energy, why we want energy? Because we go for number of activities. So our activities are related with the motion of particles or objects. So again, when I say energy takes many forms: mechanical, solar, chemical, thermal, nuclear, electrical, geothermal, wind, tidal, ocean, MHD, fuel cell. These are the newer technologies, these are coming. But however, if you see energy, it is basically thermal energy which is coming from coal, which we are getting as electrical energy, and we are reusing. They say that roughly some 60 to 70% energy we are deriving from coal, and therefore coal has got a great importance. Coal is mined now. People say that will coal be mined in next 100 years? See, recent survey, if you just read newspapers, has shown that 80% of thermal power plants are coming in ASEAN countries in next decade. That means we are continuing. See, European countries may have just stopped producing coal and going for the thermal energy from the burning of the coal, but we in India, what I feel is that we will be continuing to get thermal energy by burning the coal. So coal will be having more, that is, importance in our country. So therefore, what I feel is that coal mines are foundation of energy of a nation. Whatever knowledge I have got, I know that whenever you are going in the mines, you have got number of gases, of the very dangerous gases inside. And instead of using the IC engines and all that, compressors are being used to drive the compressors. Means the pneumatic tools are used generally in the mine machineries, because there are fire hazards, there are thermal hazards, and persons who are working in the mines are continuously subjected to very harsh condition. But still, again I say, coal is mined and will be mined for next 100 years. So we, the engineer, should know what are the hazards, how that has to be prevented, what is the risk involved. And for this, Dr. Ajaya is a very right person who is going to enlighten us regarding how to identify various hazards, how to assess the risk in the coal mines. So I hope this webinar will definitely enhance your knowledge on the above topic. So I pray to God, let this webinar be interactive, interesting, and a game changer for all of you. Thank you. Over to Professor Kishore.
Thank you, sir, for your brief address. As we all know that the topic for today's webinar is hazard identification and risk assessment with focus on coal mines. Dear friends, as we all know that mining is an hazardous profession. And when a mining engineer talks of hazard, he has to take care of the people who are working under him and also the environment in which he is working. Add to that the machineries. So hazard identification becomes inherent part of mining engineering profession. Unless and until we identify the hazard, we cannot find protective measures for prevention of hazards. So once we identify the hazards, then the next part would be assessment of hazards, assessment of risk. With the hazard, what kind of risk is associated? Once you identify the risk associated with the hazard, the next important step we need to calculate is what is the probability of happening of this risk. All these things will be dealt in greater detail by Dr. Ajaya Shankar Gupta in his speech. And now I have the proud privilege of introducing before you our keynote speaker for today's function. Dear friends, the keynote speaker for today's function is Dr. Ajaya Shankar Gupta Ainapur. Currently is residing at Hyderabad. He is the assessor for JRDQV Award. It is the Tata Group's award based on Malcolm Bulbridge National Quality Award of USA. Assessor for CII Exim Award, Best Quality Coordinator from 1999 to 2000 in Tata Steel. He is a Six Sigma Green Belt holder. He is a lead auditor, ISO 9001, OHSAS 18001, ISO 45001, ISO 14001, ISO 27001, and IA on ISO 17020. He is a first class manager's certificate of competency from Director General of Mine Safety. He's trained on PCMM gap analysis and assessment of maturity level. Trained by QCI as Train the Trainer for WASH schemes. Dear friends, his total industrial experience spans over 37 years, in which 19 years he has worked in Tata Steel Mines Division. He joined Tata Steel 1982 as graduate trainee and worked in different positions in operations and as a head of TQM department. He implemented TQM ISO 9000 quality circles, 5S teams, quality improvement projects, Tata Business Excellence Model, balance scorecard concept, positional training concept, etc. 20 months he has served in Nigerian with the Dangote Group as Senior General Manager, Mining Services from 2015 to 2017. He's got 14 years training and consultancy services for implementing Business Excellence Award models, Balance Scorecard EHS for ESG API specifications. 2 years with Tata Projects, it's an EPC company, as a consultant to implement Tata Business Excellence Model drafted vision, mission values, and balance scorecard and EHS system deployment. He has published papers. I will give you a brief gist of his paper publications.
Mr. Kishore, it is becoming too long. Thank you.
Okay, sir. So he has published 4 papers, and with this, I invite our keynote speaker of today's function, Dr. Ajaya Shankar Gupta Ainapur, to please conduct this session further. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Kishore, for elaborate introduction. Thank you. I will be happy to share my little knowledge with your students and faculty. It's a great opportunity for me also. And I will be discussing mostly on the ISO 45001, which is related to occupational health and safety management system, under which hazard identification risk assessment standard is there. Those points I will be discussing, and then I will tell little about the guidelines given by Director General of Mine Safety on coal similar risk assessment in coal mines. I will share my screen. If you have any questions, you can put the questions in the chat box. And my request for the students is to be attentive and try to understand, as there will be little test in between. Every maybe after every 20-30 minutes, there is a small test. Otherwise, you people will get bored, and you have to answer those tests in the chat box. You can put the answers in the chat box. So that is what generally I try to follow. Are you able to see my screen? Kishore, please help me.
Yes. I'm able to see your screen, sir. Yes.
Yeah. In case of any problem, audio, video problem, you can tell me. Because in Google, we cannot see the audience. That is the problem. In Zoom, we have that facility.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Screen is clear?
Screen is clearly visible, sir. Yes.
Okay. So basically, ISO 45001 is the standard related to occupational health and safety management system, which is an international standard. So prior to this, there was an occupational health and safety assessment series, OSHA's 18001, related to health and safety. So now this standard, international standard, has replaced that old standard. And for those who are not aware of ISO, let me give brief about the ISO, International Organization for Standardization, which is a worldwide federation of national standards, and different countries are members in this. Maybe around 174 or some countries are members in this. And this organization develops the standards for the industry support. Whatever the industry requirement, they go on adding the standards. They develop the standards, which are across the globe. They are accepted as authority and certification standards. It's an independent, non-governmental international organization. There are about 164 national standard bodies who are the members in this standards organization. Through its members, it brings together experts to share knowledge and develop voluntarily. Consensus-based means agreed between the different technical experts related to that from different countries. All the experts have to agree and come out with the relevant international standards, which are the global requirement basically. So as I was telling, prior to ISO 45001, there was OSHA's 18001 by British standards. So that was a British standard, British specification rather. So now the world over, countries felt that occupational health and safety management standard is required. So they have come out with ISO 45001 in 2018 only. It is a very recent standard. This its central secretary is in Geneva. The work of preparation of international standard normally carried out by technical committees. For every standard they want to come out, they form a cross technical committee who are experts in that subject. They come together and prepare the draft standards. Then those draft standards are kept for comments from the experts across the globe. After getting the feedback, they prepare the final standards. Are the standards mandatory? No, as I was telling, it is a voluntary organization. They are voluntary. It is an NGO. It is not a governmental organization, or it is not under United Nations. It has no power to enforce the compliance of the standard it develops. It is only developing the standards. It is not enforcing the implementation of standard. But it has become a voluntary and market requirements. Those who are aware about ISO 9001, which is a quality management system developed in 1987. First, it was published in 1987, ISO 9001. So that standard became very popular across the globe, and people are adopting this as a mandatory requirement for many of the companies, many of the suppliers also. Some countries have adopted these standards as regulatory framework also. In some countries, they said that if any company wants to operate in our country, they should have ISO 45001, occupational health and safety management, or environmental management, or quality management as mandatory. Anyway, those are the decisions of those countries. It is not a enforcement by ISO, but it is the decision of those countries. However, conformity assessment. Conformity assessment means whether the company claiming ISO 9001, ISO 14001, ISO 45001, whether they are meeting the requirements or not. So who will assess and certify? For this, ISO doesn't have any role. This International Organization for Standardization doesn't have any role. This is a matter between a supplier and a customer. Sometimes what we call second type audits, that is customer conducting audit on suppliers, like that. There are specialized third parties for carrying out this job. So there are third party agencies who are conducting the assessment and giving the certification saying that this company is meeting the requirements of ISO 9001, this company is meeting the requirements of ISO 45001, like that. There are companies like Bureau of Veritas, Bureau of Indian Standards, DNV, TUV. Those are the third party agencies who are certifying this. Sometimes national legislation may be enforced to be comply with ISO standards. As far as ISO 9001 was there, many of Indian companies also enforced this. Even government supported implementation of this through MSME. Certification bodies often carry out this job and is an important aspect for the trade, for business. So if any company says that I have ISO 9001, that means you can believe in the quality of their company's work. So like that, companies get a brand value and they improve their business. Coming to ISO 45001, there are some standard definitions given in that standard. See, generally across the globe, there will be different definitions, different interpretation of the words, applicable clauses like that. So whenever the ISO are developing the standards, they try to give a standard definition which is applicable across the globe. OH Indus management system means it is a management system or part of the management system, because many companies have integrated management system. Within that integrated management system, occupational health and safety management is a part, quality management system is a part, and environment and health and safety management system is a part of it. Note 1 to entry means actually these are the terminology used in the ISO standards. The intended outcomes of the management system are to prevent injury and ill health. Are you able to hear any problem, sir, in audio video?
No problem in audio video, sir. We are able to hear you. Yes.
Okay. Very clear. I got a deep sound, that's why I got doubt. So this management system is basically to prevent injury and ill health. Health related and physical injury related. To workers and to provide safe and healthy workplaces. Injury and ill health means what? We may have different definitions. Here, adverse effect on the physical, mental, or cognitive condition of a person. Here, you have to note that it is talking about the mental health of the worker also. It is not only physical health, it is also talking about the mental health. What do you mean by hazard? Here, hazard means a source where there can be an incident. If an incident happens, it can cause injury. So definition is like source with a potential to cause injury and ill health. There is a source, there is a situation, there is a condition that if it happens, it can create, cause injury or ill health to the public, people. It may be people means it may be employees, it may be non-employees also, it may be community around you also. Hazards can include sources with potential to cause harm or hazardous situation or circumstances with potential for exposure leading to injury and ill health. Source with a potential to cause. Source, hazard doesn't mean it has created any harm, but it has a source. It can create an injury. Incident. It is an occurrence arising out of or in the course of work that could or does result into the injury to health and injury and ill health. See here, incident can result into an accident, injury, or it may be a just near miss. So incident has occurred, but nothing happened to anybody. What we say, bach gaya, like that. An incident where injury and ill health occurs is sometimes referred as an accident. If it has caused any damage, then we call it as an accident. An incident where no injury and no ill health occurred, but has potential to do so, may be referred as near miss. Sometimes we call near miss case, near hit case, or close call. Like this, the incident can result into an injury, accident, or it just warn you, just near miss. And another important term is a risk. What is the meaning of risk? It is effect of an uncertainty. Uncertainty is there. So it may happen, it may not happen. So uncertainty is there. What is the effect of that uncertainty? It's known as a risk. An effect is a deviation from the expected. Deviation from the expected. Normal say, what we expected normal way, but it happened in a different way. Deviation from the normal way. The result may be a positive or a negative. Uncertainty is the state, even partial state or full state, of some deficiency related to information or understanding or knowledge of an event, its consequences or likelihood. So uncertainty related to some lacuna in the system or some lacuna in the understanding or knowledge of the or understanding about the event or the impact of those events and probability, likelihood. Risk is often characterized by reference to potential events or a combination of those. So there may be a resultant of different events or different activities. Risk is often expressed in terms of a combination of the consequences of an event. Consequences. So after incident occurred, what are the impact on health and safety, including changes in circumstances and associated likelihood of occurrence, probability of occurrence. So this is what I was telling you. All of you try to answer this question, put it in the chat box. First you write down on your chat a piece of paper. Question number one, A or B or C or D. Question number two, A, R, B, R, C, D. Like that, you write down on a sheet of paper and then put it into the chat box. So I give 3 minutes time. Okay, many of you have answered. Okay, friends, any one of you, first question, what is the answer? Some of you have written B, but actually it is A. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Audible, audible.
Yeah. One is A and two is D, all the above. See, basically the idea is when we conduct training, people should have a review of what they have learned and what is their understanding level. So people confusion should not be there. Third is B, injury and ill health. How many of you have corrected, given correct answer? Third as D, no, third as B, some of you have written. You are able to see my screen now?
No, sir.
It's visible now, sir.
Yeah, now you are seeing injury and ill health, adverse effect on physical, mental or cognitive conditions of a person. And what was our question? Three is B. And fourth is, fourth one. How many of you answered fourth one? Yeah, fourth one, yes. Good. Any questions on this till now, whatever we have discussed? Anybody has any question? As I said, if you have any questions, you can put it in the chat box. We can discuss in the end. Now, total risk management process. You are able to see my screen with a flowchart now?
Yes, sir. It's visible. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the risk management activity starts with identification of the activities. What are the activities we are performing in the organization? What are the activities we are doing in the mines? Starting from drilling, blasting, shoveling, trucking, dozing, everything, all the activities are to be listed down. See, what the standard asks is you have to write down the activities which are routine, which are non-routine. Means you may be doing once in a year, once in 2 years, once in 5 years also. Those type of activities also you have to identify. The major step first is listing all the activities. Then for every activity, you need to identify what are the potential hazards in that activity. Suppose I'm doing drilling. What are the potential hazards in drilling? Person can fall down. If there are misfires, there may be explosion. There may be tripping of the equipment, falling of the equipment, falling of the machine in the next bench if it is an open cast, fall, roof fall if it is an underground. Like that, you have to list down the activity and list down all the potential hazards related to that activity. Then you analyze the risks. While analyzing the risks, you will see what is the probability of that incident occurring. It happens, what are the consequences? What are the consequences? Determine the likelihood, that is probability into exposure, we call likelihood and consequences. Then estimate the risk level. See, risk level, anybody says that there is no risk, he is wrong. Always there is a risk in any activity. And whether it is tolerable, bearable, trivial or not, that we have to estimate. Then we estimate the risk level for that. Whether we can face that risk or it is very severe that we should not go there till the risk is reduced to tolerable level. This is called risk evaluation. Then for any risk analysis method, we define an acceptable criteria. Suppose it is on the number scale, 200 points and above is high risk. 200 points to 100 points is medium. Below 100 points is tolerable. Something like that, we'll be defining acceptable criteria. Then compare that risk level with the acceptable criteria. Then you define with acceptance. It is a low risk, continue. It is a medium risk, then you have to take actions to reduce it. Cost benefit analysis and then risk reduction measures. If it is a high risk, you may have to compulsorily risk reduction measure till you till you are not taking risk reduction measures, you cannot start the activity. Then after taking the measures, then you reassess, and till it comes to low and medium and low tolerable level, you cannot start the year. Then define the functional requirements and indicators and start working. Whenever we do risk assessment, first of all, we have to form a team. See, why team? Most of the times what happens, many companies, one safety officer sits and prepare the risk assessment. No, it has to be a team. Here, the team should have the members from the workmen also, because the workmen are the best have the best knowledge about the potential hazards. So the team should consist of minimum 3 to 4 persons, minimum, depending upon the nature of the activity. Then you will be defining the routine activities, non-routine activities, and emergency situations. Emergency situations like any explosion or any earthquake, those type of things also are there in the standard. Identifying the hazards. See, basically, we suggest to have an hazard prompt list, a list containing all potential hazards related to your industry. It has to be made specific to your industry. Sorry, 1 minute, just. So based on the criteria we defined, we have to assess the risk and rank them into three categories, like what I was showing earlier, low risk, medium risk, and high risk, like that, some criteria. Then treatment controls and action plans based on the risk level, where the high risk level is there, you plan additional controls like that. Then induction, training, and continuous improvement of the persons doing that job. See, most of the times what happens, they prepare this beautiful risk management plan. It is a document lying in the office of the safety officer or a manager, but they are not training the people on that. So every new entrant has to be given induction training. During the induction training, you have to tell them about the risk assessment and hazards also. And all the employees are to be covered related to their activity, potential hazards, and the control plans. Then reporting if at all anything happens. Accident, incident reporting, and investigation. So once we have implemented safety management system, doesn't mean there are zero accidents or zero incidents. Incidents, I was telling, near miss cases also. So those type of things are to be captured, investigated, analyzed, and improve the system. Then as an improvement system, people conduct audits and review and revise the procedures, systems also. Guidelines also are to be revised based on our experience. So there are some simple questions which will help you in identifying the hazards and assessment of the risk. Like what can go wrong? It will tell you us about hazard identification. What can go wrong? While drilling operating, person can slip and fall, or tools can fall down, so which can cause injury. How often does it happen? Frequency analysis, how often we are drilling, whether it is a routine activity, non-routine activity, it is daily or once in a while, something like overhauling of equipment, maybe done in 10 years, 15 years, but annual maintenance once in a year. So like that, for all the activities, we have to identify the potential hazards. How severe it is, suppose if it happens, if the person falls down, what can be the consequences? If he is operating on a jackhammer, the injury may be something different. If he is operating on a heavy drilling machine, it may be different. So everything has to be site specific. Everything has to be site specific, mine specific, location specific. Does it matter? Means what is the risk level? Assess the risk level. It is a tolerable or intolerable, medium or high like that. Then what should we do if it is high? Then we have to do risk management. Is it okay? Which is done through audits and reviews. So this is how questions will help you in preparing a beautiful or good safety management plan. Hazard prompt list, I was telling, there is a big, very big list. Just a sample I'm showing you. So like the, suppose I'm doing a drilling. Can there be a slip and fall on the same level? Can there be a fall of persons from the height? So for every step, for every activity, this hazard prompt list will help you in identifying the potential hazards. Suppose I am driving a car. Can there be a slip and fall? No. Fall of person from height? No. Fall of tools? No. Inadequate headroom? Possible while entering into the car, I may get head injury. Hazards as well, manual lifting? No. So hazard from plant and machinery, commissioning, operation, maintenance. Like this, we try to make hazard prompt list, maybe 100, 200 points also may be there, depending upon the nature of industry. This hazard prompt list will help us in identifying all the potential hazards. Then we do risk assessment. So when we do risk assessment, there are two types of risks. One is base risk, another is residual risk. What is that base risk? Means when I am doing an activity without any controls, without any protection equipment or something like that. So what is the level of risk involved in that? Suppose I am driving a car without any training, without any license, without any safety belt. All those, nothing is there, but I am a fresher coming and driving a car. So what is the base risk? It will be very high. Then we put the controls like driver with license. Driver has to use the safety belt, and the test is there and authorization is there, all those things. Then what is the residual risk? After the present controls, what is the risk left? Still, does it require any additional controls or not? So there is generally two types of risk assessment. Just a minute. Okay, friends, sorry. Then risk assessment. In this base risk assessment, ignores existing controls and therefore evaluates the inherent risk associated with any activity or situation. That is what I was telling you. Without any controls, what is risk involved in that activity? Sometimes we overdo. The base risk is tolerable. It is not very severe or very high risk. Doesn't require any control. Still, we try to overdo, overprotect. So if base risk is tolerable level, why should we do anything extra? Something like that. Base risk assessment is used to identify whether an activity or situation has a sufficient level of risk. It has a more risk, which needs additional controls, or doesn't require any control. Associated risk to merit its management. Occupational health and safety management systems. That means there is responsibilities to be allocated, performance to be monitored, audited, recorded, training to be given. All those things are the management system. So if the base risk warrants for additional controls or no, it is something like aspect impact evaluation in ISO 14001. ISO 14001 is environmental management system, EMS. 9001 is QMS, quality management system. 14001 is EMS, environmental management system. 45001 is occupational health and safety management system. So in environmental management system, also we do this type of assessment. Residual risk. It is an assessment which takes into account the level of risk while the activity is under control of the organization. We have different controls. Activity is performed by certain trained people, certain qualified people, competent people, all those things. Even after that, what is the risk level? Still the risk is under control, or does it require additional control? Generally, risk assessment is the residual risk only most of the times. Residual risk is therefore used to measure how well an activity or situation is managed in our company, in our organization, at present situation, at present, the activity is under control and there is no high risk involved or not. Does it require warrants for any additional control? Where the level of residual risk means after the present controls, if the risk is unacceptable, then high controls need to be modified or the risk eliminated in some way. So if the residual risk is unacceptable, then we need to have additional control. This type of risk assessment is often used to identify objectives for system improvement. So wherever these type of high risk areas are there, then we need to prepare some management programs, control plans, additional control activities like that. Then for calculating the risk, what we do, we were telling earlier, likelihood into consequences. Risk score is likelihood of this incident occurring, and if at all it occurs, what will be the consequences? Likelihood is calculated the probability and exposure, probability of incident occurring, and how long that people are exposed to that incident, that activity, that hazard, and what are the consequences. So generally, suppose we have a 10-point scale like that, then we start defining out of 500 price 200 and above is intolerable like that. We define the yet. I will be showing some sample also for that. Try to answer these questions. Take 5 minutes. All of you are able to see the question?
Yes, sir. Questions are visible.
Okay, thank you. Like earlier, put the answers on a sheet. Answer all the questions at a time. Don't go on answering one ka ek bar dega, second ka baad mein dega. First, write down a sheet of paper and then put it all together. Okay, answered. Okay, some of you have already answered all the 4 questions. Okay. Okay. Just correct your answers if anybody has written wrong. First question is risk. Anybody has doubt on this? Hazard is source of potential risk, and injury and ill health is also separate. Hazard can cause injury and ill health. Then effect of that uncertainty is risk. So one is C, and two. Let me see how many of you answered correctly. Two A. See, the two question is a typical question. Estimation of risk level will give any one of these. It will indicate it is a low risk or medium risk or high risk. For any activity, all the three will not be there. All the above will not be there. Any one of the above. After risk estimation, you will get low risk or medium risk or high risk, like that. That is what we have shown in there. Some of you answered three because you thought that it will lead to three. But usme hum logon ko milega, when we do risk, it may give you one. So those who have written one and C also correct. C is more accurate. One also, you can say, okay. There are two types of risk assessment, base risk and residual risk. C, base risk assessment ignores existing control. That is true. Any questions? I think Kishoreji, if there are any questions in the chat box, please monitor and let me know.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm regularly monitoring the chat box. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
So as I was telling, risk, calculating risk, probability, exposure into severity or consequences. Probability, generally people give one scale like that, maybe well expected means 100% possible, ye to hona hi hai, ye to hoga hi, something like that. Then quite possible, unusual but possible, remotely possible, conceivable but unlikely. So is tarah ka scale dete hain. So these scales, there are different types of scales available, different industries have different scales, but whatever scale we use, we adopt in the company, in the organization, same scale has to be used across the organization. Ek department drilling wala karega ek scale se, shoveling wala dusra scale se, maintenance department dusra scale se karega? No. It will give a wrong comparison. See, here what we are doing the risk assessment is to know the high hazardous areas, high risky areas in our organization, in our mining activity, and try to control that. So then we have to follow same scale across the organization. Same understanding has to be there in the people, and wherever we are getting high risks in every department, those high risk areas will be first priority to control. So there has to be what we call apple to apple comparison between the departments. I will be showing you some different scales also. So this, I think this was given in the DGMS guidelines also. एक्सपोजर डेली करता है, कंटिन्यूअस करता है, हर दिन करता है, तीन चार बार करता है, वीकली, मंथली, ओकेशनली, वंस इन फाइव इयर्स, वंस इन टेन इयर्स, सो लाइक दैट. सो एक्सपोजर का ये करता है, वंस इन हंड्रेड इयर्स मतलब क्या हो सकता है माइनिंग में एक्टिविटी, Maybe it is a closure of the mine. While closure of the mines, what are the potential hazards? See, nowadays, whenever you prepare the plan, you have to prepare for the total life cycle of the mine. Then consequences. Several dead, one dead, significant chance of fatality, one permanent disability, small chance of disability, many lost time injuries, one lost time injury like that, small injury. So this is another scale for the consequences. Mane ekik scale mein probability, exposure and consequences. ये तीनों का मल्टीप्लिकेशन करेगा रिस्क लेवल आएगा. देयर इज अनदर स्केल. दिस स्केल इज अ टिपिकल डेवलप्ड बाय ऑस्ट्रेलियन सेफ्टी काउंसिल. प्रोबेबिलिटी ही हैज गिवन ए सपोज अनयूजुअल बट पॉसिबल प्रोबेबिलिटी. एक्सपोजर ये डेली होता है फ्रीक्वेंटली. देन यू विल बी कनेक्टिंग लाइक दिस एंड wherever the tie line cuts, there you will take. And then you see, suppose it happens, what is the consequence? Only first aid or serious or fatality? Suppose if it is fatality, then take. This risk score is very high. Now you will see risk reduction karna hai. After our risk reduction measures and risk is reduced by 50%, then you will be connecting like this 50% line. Then here tie break comes. Then for this risk reduction, how much we are going to spend? $1 million or $100,000, something like that. Suppose even if it is $100 million, then you connect like this and connect. It says then even highly justified. So like this, when we do the workshop, we try to do different for different activities. There is a, in fact, automatic scale tool is also there for this series. Then there are certain tables also, what we call heat matrix. So here they have given severity and likelihood. In this scale, are you able to read this? Are you able to read?
Yes, sir.
Otherwise, let me zoom it.
Yes. Now,
yeah. Likelihood they have defined here. More than one incident per annum, one ka chance hai. Many probabilities, several between. Single between 1 to 10 incidents, 100 years. So this is a in fact this was for a petroleum industry scale criticality, multiple greater than major single severity scale. Then they have given this heat matrix: red, intolerable; medium, risk; low risk, like that. What is that? Negligible, marginal, unacceptable. Wherever that red is there, unacceptable. So like that they have defined. They will compare. There is another type of EAP where risk level is done based on impact on people and impact on equipment, impact on production loss or value-wise, money-wise also. Here what that fatality, equipment damage or production loss, whichever is high, we have to take that, this point's main. So like this, they have defined the scale related to damage to equipment, loss in production, like that. So first of all, whenever we start risk assessment, we define our scales and we define our tolerable limits also. So here within brackets we will be writing score: trivial, tolerable, moderate, substantial, intolerable, like that. And then what is to be done? If it is trivial, no action is required. If it is tolerable, no additional controls are required. कंसिडरेशन में बी गिवन टू ए मोस्ट कॉस्ट इफेक्टिव सॉल्यूशन. कभी कभी होता है ना, टॉलरेबल होने के बाद भी देर इज स्टिल चांस ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर रिस्क रिडक्शन. देन टाइम वी हैव टू सी द कॉस्ट इफेक्टिव सॉल्यूशन. देन मॉडरेट एफर्ट शुड बी मेड टू रिड्यूस द रिस्क, बट द कॉस्ट ऑफ प्रिवेंशन शुड बी केयरफुली मेजर्ड एंड लिमिटेड. रिस्क रिडक्शन मेजर शुड बी इम्प्लीमेंटेड. मॉडरेट में डेफिनेटली रिस्क रिडक्शन करना ही है. देन सब्सटेंशियल रिस्क, वर्क शुड नॉट बी स्टार्टेड अंटिल द रिस्क हैज बीन रिड्यूस्ड. Intolerable work should not be started or continued until the risk has been reduced. If it is not possible to reduce the risk with unlimited resources, work has to remain prohibited, cancelled. इस तरह का हम लोग प्रोसीजर बनाते हैं. एक्चुअली हजार्ड आइडेंटिफिकेशन रिस्क असेसमेंट प्रोसीजर बनाते हैं कंपनी में. इन दैट कंपनी वी ट्राई टू डिफाइन दीज लेवल्स. देन कंट्रोल करना कैसा है. Suppose it is a very hazardous activity. For that also, we need to think in a systematic way. Suppose blasting is there. Blasting is causing a very hazardous activity. It is nearer to villages. It can impact the community around you. It can cause accidents to the local citizens other than our equipment. Suppose then, what is to be done? First, we will see elimination. You will think. Modification to the process method or material to eliminate the hazard completely. Suppose, can I eliminate the blasting completely? Then you will see ripper mining or different type of mining. No, that is not possible. I cannot eliminate. Then what is next? Of course, example, removing the hazard, stopping using the hazardous chemicals or applying ergonomics approaches when planning new workplaces, eliminating monotonous work. So they have given some examples. I am giving you the mining example. Blasting eliminate कर सकते हैं क्या? नहीं, नहीं कर सकते हैं. Then it is very hard rock. Ripper भी काम नहीं करेगा. Then what is substitution? Replace the explosive material or substance or method which is less hazardous. So here 100% reduction, here 75% reduction, substitution. Then separation, isolation, isolating the hazard from persons by safeguarding us by space or time separation. This is what generally we try to do. We try either remove the villagers from that village, or we will be conducting the blasting in such time that when the all the people are within their house, maybe early morning, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, jo karte hain. So it is something like time separation, or sometimes in between the shifts we do. So this is called separation. Administration, adjusting the time or conditions of risk exposure. Administrative controls, people will not be exposed much, so that you will be doing certain shelters, risk shelter where it is people will be staying very away from the hazardous area, or in between shift also administrative controls like that. Then provide training to the people, improving the skills, therefore making task less hazardous are to persons. So improving skills in blasting or the method of blasting like that. So which is also we consider 20% reduction. And finally PPE, personal protective equipment, juta topi jo hum log bolta hai, that can give you only 5%. Generally what we start the moment safety matlab niche se start karte hain, PPE se shuru karte hain, PPE dene se ho gaya. No, PPE is the last resort. This is how risk control has to be discussed, planned. The team, jo risk assessment team rehta hai, first they will see, can we eliminate? No. Is there any substitution? Yes, then go for substitution. If there is no substitution, then can we separate, isolate the people from the exposure? Then what are the other administrative controls we can take? What are different trainings or methods or we have to adopt? Then finally, what are the PPE required? That PPE required also specific to the nature of job. Like jaisa drilling kar raha hai, jackhammer driller hai, to aap juta, hand gloves, mask, helmet, sab kuch dena padega. Suppose is the drilling in the big heavy HME drill hai, so then only cabin controls dekhna padega, cabin condition, cabin air conditioned cabin or something like that, some other tools, PPE required. He may not require mask also sometimes. So this is one sample of risk assessment related to a mine. Then we will be using the template. Then here, the unit, mining operation, drilling, people affected by this activity are drill operator and helpers, the team members who has done this. Then activity steps, movement of drill equipment, positioning of the boom in a sleeping position. Ye karne ka time, what are the potential hazards? Chances of bursting or leakage of a connected hydraulic hoses causing injuries to eyes. Once we write this hazard, what are the present controls we have? Persons advised to be away from the machine while doing the operation, checking the physical condition of hydraulic hoses, check the machine for safe marking conditions, and operator trained like that. Then what is the risk level? So wherever the risk is intolerable, then you will be planning for this. Unless the operator requires, the helper should be remain 15 meters away from the drill machine, something like. So this was drilling dust hazard, dust and smoke hazard. So like that, steps we are writing. For every step, we are trying to identify the potential hazards and their consequences. What is the hazard and what can happen? Then what are the present controls? With present controls, what we call residual risk. That residual risk before new controls, probability, exposure, severity, the scales which we had shown. Then if risk is more than 25, we had suggested that risk control plan was telling if you have more than 25, additional controls are required. Then additional controls ke baad kitna risk rahega. After risk reduction, what is the risk level? So from 40, it has come to 4. Just another brief. Okay, friends, some of you have answered. First question is probability. The chance that a person will be harmed is a probability, not exposure. Exposure is timeline. Daily exposure ho raha hai ki once in a year exposure ho raha hai, monthly ho raha hai, frequently ho raha hai, continuous ho raha hai, like that. So it is chance that a person is harmed is a probability. Probability of incident occurring, probability of accident occurring, like that. Two, risk-based control plan defines all the above. D is correct. Two is D. Three, some of you have written A. No. First, eliminate karne ke liye sochega. Baad mein substitute kuch hai kya dekhega. Then separation sochega. B is the correct answer here. B is the correct answer. Any questions? Anybody has any questions in the chat box? Any doubts on these answers?
No questions in the chat box till now, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now we will go to safety management plan under coal mines regulation 2017. See, whatever till now I have covered is ISO 45001 hazard identification and risk assessment guidelines and general practices, and try to interpret in our mining language. Now what we will see, what are the key requirements under coal mines regulation. Coal mines regulation 2017 warns that every company should prepare a safety management plan under CMR 104. Coal mines regulation number 104 requires that company should plan safety management plan. As per regulation number 3, notice of opening shall be accompanied by safety management plan. Notice of opening, it is for a new mine. Any new mine, before starting, they need to have a safety management plan. Then what about the existing mines within a 1 year, they had given the date. They had given the date from 27 November, say 2018 November ke andar dena chahiye. Then what it should contain? The safety management plan of every mine shall contain identify the hazards to health and safety. So that is what we were discussing. Hazards. What is an hazard? A potential source. Different activities mein potential sources rehta hai hazards ka, which can lead for a accident and ill health, cause resulting into ill health or injury or even fatality, like that. In management plan, safety management plan, identify the hazards, assess the risk to health and safety. That is what we will discuss. Risk assessment based on the probability, exposure and consequences or severity. Is tino ka mutabik, which is the risk, which are the high hazardous activities or which are the high risk level hazards. Record the significant hazards identified and risk assessed. So significant hazard terminology here used, what we used, high risk area. So whichever is having high risk, those are called as a significant hazards. Make those records available for the inspection by the employees. A hazard and identification jo karta hai, every employee should be aware of that. You should keep them knowing that these are the potential hazards in your work area. This is generally missed by many companies. And even in many private companies, they don't want to share with the employees. Khali risk management plan banake office mein rahega, DGMS ko copy de dega. No. These records also should be available to employees or employee representative, union representatives, like that. Follow an appropriate process for identification of hazards and assessment of risk. Follow an appropriate process. That is what I discussed just now. I have discussed with you an internationally acceptable ISO 45001 methodology. So appropriate process. I have discussed with you this appropriate process. The owner, agent, and manager of every mine, after consulting the safety committee of the mine and internal safety organization, ISO. I thought some of you will answer ISO, internal safety organization. What was that ISO? International Organization for Standardization. Shall determine all measures necessary to eliminate, this is what we discussed, eliminate any recorded risk. Control the risk at source. In this way, we defined the control plan, na? Eliminate, substitute, separation, administrative control like that. Minimize the risk. And insofar as the risk remains, provide the PPE, institute a program to monitor the risk to which employees may be exposed. First eliminate karo, then control karo. Elimination nahi hota hai to control karo. Elimination ke baad, what will be risk in the new activity? Control, minimize the risk with additional controls, then provide PPE and start monitoring the risk level. Based on the identified hazards and risks, an auditable document called safety management plan to be prepared. What we call in ISO languages manual. ISO 14001, 9001, 45001, ISO manual. Usi ke par safety management plan bol rahe hain. Safety management plan to be prepared, which includes organizational structure for this managing the safety, internal safety organization structure. Who is responsible for what? Who will do risk assessment? Who will do monitoring? Who will be controlled? What is the role of safety committee? Who are the members of the safety committee? All those things. Then planning, how we are going to do this safety management control. Within that planning only, this SOP procedure has to come. Then what are the different activities to be performed under safety management plan? And who are responsible for that? Responsibilities identified for risk assessment, risk control, then monitoring, recording, or training like that. Then practices and approaches, processes. Then procedures to be documented. Procedures, processes, and resources for developing, implementing, achieving, reviewing, and maintaining safety and health policy of a company. See, basically safety and health policy at a company, every company has to define the health and safety policy in which there is a commitment from the management. Management ka commitment hota hai, we will achieve this. So for achieving that intent of that health and safety policy, we have to develop a procedures for doing that. It shall be the duty of the owner, agent, and manager to implement the measures determined necessary. Based on your risk assessment, what are the controls have to be implemented, present controls and proposed controls, and contained in the safety management plan. All that implementation is the duty of the owner, agent, and the manager. Yahan tino ka responsibility hai. The safety management plan shall contain defined mine safety and health policy of the company. Just now I was telling you health and safety policy of the company, which is signed by highest authority of the company, and in which we mention about the commitment of the management, the procedure we are going to adopt like that. A plan to implement the policy. How the mine or mines intend to develop capabilities to achieve the policy. Capabilities to achieve the policy means competency of the people and upgradation of the technology and required safety equipment. Principal hazard management plans. Main hazards jo rehta hai, principal hazards terminology they are using, meaning high risk areas, high hazardous activities ka manage control plans. Then standard operating procedures, SOPs. Then ways to measure, monitor, and evaluate performance of the safety management plan. That is what we were telling, that audits and reviews karna hai, wo hai. And to correct the matters, they do not confirm the safety management plan. Then based on audit and inspections, you take corrective actions for this. A plan to regularly review and continually improve the safety management plan. Regularly review and continually improvement. So basically ISO 45000 mein, we call this as a audits and management review. Management review committee bolke rehta hai usme. A plan to review safety management plan, if significant changes occur, if there is any change in technology, change in method of working, even if change in people also, ek operator jaake dusra operator agar aaya, tab bhi hum log risk assessment fir se karna hai. Kyunki the skill and competency and the knowledge of the person is different. So, aadmi change hone ke baad bhi kabhi kabhi accidents hota hai, dekhiye. So, that is why whenever there is a change, we need to reassess the risk and take the controls. And in details of involvement of mine workers in its development and application, in its development, mane development of the safety management plan mein worker ka involvement hona chahiye, implementation mein worker ka involve hona chahiye. Periodically review the hazards identified and risk assessed. It is not a one-time activity, and we know that the mining phase, as it advances, the risk and the situation conditions will go on changing. जैसे अंडरग्राउंड माइन में एक जगह रूफ स्ट्रांग रहेगा, एक जगह रूफ वीक रहेगा, इनिशियली वीक होगा, बाद में स्ट्रांग भी हो सकता है, इस तरह. सो इट हैज टू बी ए पीरियडिकली रिव्यूड एंड सबमिट ए कॉपी टू रीजनल इंस्पेक्टर ऑफ द माइंस. ओनर एजेंट ऑफ मैनेजर मैनेजर ऑफ एवरी माइन शैल बी रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर इफेक्टिव इंप्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ सेफ्टी मैनेजमेंट प्लान. यहां तीनों का रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी है, ओनर कैन नॉट एस्केप, ओनर का भी अभी रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी है. And in the standard, they have given certain identified risks, 28 hazards they have identified, 28 hazards initially identified, like existing mine fire, roof fall, a circular mein diya hua hai, DGMS ka circular mein, mine gases, waterlogged workings, survey incorrect mine plan is also potential hazard, improper survey instruments, lack of skilled persons, these are all potential hazards identified and detailed in the standard. There are 28. This is there in the technical circular 5 of 2016. Just a brief review on this. Okay, friends, some of you written something different. One first question ka D hai, second question ka bhi D hai. All the above. And third mein, C is the correct. Owner, agent and manager of every mine. It is not every employee or only owner and agent, only manager nahi. Owner, agent and manager. Third ka C hai. Anyhow, any questions till now, whatever we have discussed? Any questions?
There are no questions in the chat box too, sir.
I think I have, you people, many of you are on laptops, so you can try. You have received one Google form in the chat box?
Yes, yes. One form we have received in the chat box, yes.
Yeah, you try to fill up that.
Okay, students will please fill up the
form. Feedback form.
Yeah, it's a feedback form. Please fill up that feedback form.
Any one of you, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask me. In fact, when we do workshop na hands-on karte hain, workshop mein theek rahega, then the same session will go for half day or one day.
Right, right, right.
Where we do exercises and hands-on all that.
Sir, can students take part in the workshops?
Yeah, yeah. See, what happens in Zoom, we have breakout teams karte hain. Idea hai na, breakout teams? So, usme kya karte hain? Teen char logon ka team banate hain. So, then those three, four persons will prepare exercise. तो उसमें क्या होता है सीनियर लोग रहता है जूनियर लोग रहता है शेयरिंग ऑफ नॉलेज शेयरिंग ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस होता है टीम एक्टिविटी में
या इट बिकम्स अ टीम एक्टिविटी करेक्ट
टीम एक्टिविटी एंड क्रॉस लर्निंग हो जाता है सीनियर्स जूनियर्स के साथ लर्निंग हो जाता है
करेक्ट 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 डॉक्टर गुप्ता सर प्लीज हाईलाइट सम इंफॉर्मेशन रिगार्डिंग योर वेबसाइट mininghrd.com हाउ दिस वेबसाइट कैन बी यूजफुल फॉर अवर स्टूडेंट्स
सी बेसिकली mininghrd.com वी हैव स्टार्टेड बिकॉज देर इज नो फोकस्ड ऑर्गेनाइजेशन सिंगल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन विच इज डूइंग एक्सक्लूसिवली फ्रॉम रिक्रूटमेंट टू व्हाट शुड आई से लीडरशिप डेवलपमेंट
राइट सर
सो वी there are many professionals mining geology and equipment all professionals we thought let us start something like that so then we developed this mininghrd.com portal and where we are trying to provide the services from recruitment skill development leadership development and training to all the people with exclusive mining experts see this risk assessment I do this training for even power plants also I do this training for even agri seeds company also I am doing but when I do for mining it will be in the language of mining the interpretation the discussion will be specific to mining like that this see people can go take that train leadership training also from any MBA college
yes
but mining specific knowledge cannot be given by them they may be talking about software industry they may be talking about other manufacturing industries but they will not be talking specific to mining so we thought let us have a mining professionals with those experience and provide those services to the industry with that idea we have started that in fact we have started recently few months back and networking has to be improved and then this pandemic is also another problem but right, we expect that we will develop this as a one of the exclusive mining HRD organization
sir can students get any help in recruitment from your portal
yeah we are planning for that only actually see we have kept industry requirements and we are also asked for people to upload their CVs
yes I have gone through your portal and there I saw there were vacancies for geologists then
because managers. Whenever we are getting some information even we unpaid also we are showing them suppose somebody, some notices are coming in our group Like Coal India notice was there. We have kept in our portal.
Yes, sir. So, sir, if students want to register to your website, can they get registered, or they have to send their resume to you directly?
No, only resume they are uploading, that's all.
That's all, okay.
Okay. But those resumes will be compiling, and then whenever there is a requirement, we will try to share those to the, let me honestly tell that till now we do not have much organizations as members. It is a beginning only.
Beginning only. But still, I will request all my students to please send their resume at your website.
After final year only.
Final year students, they can do this after the completion of the graduation.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Yeah.
Sir, apart of.
Yeah, Pranav, please continue.
Sir, apart of that, means, can you please suggest us the other branches of mining, means where we can apply? And we are getting graduate means this year, after an August, we will be graduate mining graduates, and we have to apply many more companies too. So would you recommend some to us where there are requirements? And
see, generally, if any requirement is coming, we are trying to post in the website. But if anybody, any company is asking us to recruit and help them in recruitment, then we are putting in the and circulating among the portals and LinkedIn and other things, and circulating among the groups and trying to get the Suppose we have in our database, if we have some names, we may propose their names also like that.
So I have one issue again too, sir. So many more things means where we find vacancy. Every company is asking about the experience, and only the experienced candidate every company is requiring. So how do we get experience if anyone will not be giving us any experience to us? So how will we be getting that?
You have to do some internships. Some companies take you as an intern, paid intern or free intern or with a little nominal payments like that. Internship first 1 year, 2 years. You should not expect much salary or anything. After 1 or 2 years experience, then only. That is one. Second is, some companies are recruiting as a graduate trainee itself. They will not ask any experience. They are taking freshers, graduate trainees. So graduate trainee ka job jab milta hai, usme ja sakta hai. Some call MGT mining graduate trainees, some call graduate engineer trainee, GET. Even companies like NTPC and other Coal India are taking like a management trainees. Like that. Any other questions?
Students, any other questions would you like to ask? I think Tanmay Santoshwar has asked one question. I think that is already answered. How could freshers join mining companies just after completion of our graduation? So that
that is what I'm telling.
Yes,
go for internships.
Already answered. Yes.
Yeah.
So if there are no questions, then I will request any one of the students to please propose vote of thanks.
See the response. Out of 40 students, how many of you have filled up the form? Let me know. How many of you filled up the form?
Sir, myself have filled the form, sir.
I am finding only 8 people have responded. That shows the commitment and involvement of students. That is what we are finding many of the times. The freshers doesn't have any commitment and no involvement and no subject knowledge. This is the problem. Simply joining engineering and expecting a job is also not correct. You cannot get. Maybe some students are joining only just to get the degree. And there were no questions related to subject. We don't want to improve our subject knowledge. We want to have a simply graduate certificate in the hand and search for a job. when the people conduct the interview, no knowledge, rejected. This is what happens. This is the time for learning. I agree. We enjoy and learn in the student life.